Our Father, we thank you for the refreshing time we've been having in your word as you send different ministers, your own anointed people to us to speak to us. We're praying, O Lord, that our time together here will be more enriching in Jesus' name. We pray that you open our eyes of understanding as we study 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 now. Let the truth have effect in every one of our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. We thank the Lord for what he's been revealing to us as we've been looking at the first epistle of Paul to the Thessalonians. Now we come to chapter 4, and it's titled Living in Constant Readiness for Christ's Return. The chapter we're talking about, that is the chapter from which we're taking the teaching now, is the classic, is the one that contains the classic passage on Christ's return to remove the church from the earth. That's the classic passage on the rapture of the church. Have you noticed as we look at 1 Thessalonians that every chapter closes with a statement, an allusion to the second coming of Christ? The Thessalonians had no doubt that Christ will be coming again. Look at it from chapter 1 verse 10, and to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivered us from the wrath to come. At the end of that chapter, we are told that the Thessalonians were waiting for Christ. Christ is coming again. Chapter 2 verse 19, for what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? At the end again, we're told it's coming again. Chapter 3, looking at verse 13, to the end he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. And then chapter 4, still emphasizing that Christ is coming again. Chapter 4, reading from verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, or the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. In chapter 5, looking at verse 23, that the very God of peace will sanctify you wholly. And I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see then, the second coming of Christ was so significant to the Thessalonians. And when Paul was writing to them, at the end of every chapter, he mentions the coming of the Lord again. The coming of the Lord is very significant. And as you go throughout the Bible, you'll find references on the assurance and the certainty that the Lord is coming. As you look at the last book of the Bible, Revelation, you'll find 7 times when the coming of the Lord is referred to. In Revelation chapter 1 verse 7, behold, he cometh. Chapter 2 verse 25, hold fast till I come. Chapter 3 verse 11, behold, I come quickly. In chapter 16 verse 15, behold, I come as a thief, blessed is he that watcheth. Chapter 22 verse 7, behold, I come quickly. And chapter 22 verse 12, it says again, behold, I come quickly. And in verse 20 of that last chapter, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come Lord Jesus. Once again, you'll see the importance of the coming of the Lord. He came the first time for salvation. He's coming the second time for taking the believers away. As you look at the Bible, you'll see that prophecy is very significant in the whole Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. Prophecy takes 1/5 of the scriptures. And of that, one fifth of the scriptures, one third refers to the second coming. That means if you take the whole Bible and you take all the prophecies of the Bible, you have 1/15 of all the prophecies referring to the second coming of Christ. There are over 660 general prophecies in the Bible when you classify them. 333 refer to Christ alone. 109 of those prophecies were fulfilled at the first coming of Christ, remaining 224 still to be fulfilled at the second coming of Christ. Of the 46 Old Testament prophets, less than 10 of them spoke about his first coming, while 36 of them spoke about his second coming. If you look at the Old Testament, you have 1500 Old Testament passages that refer to the second coming of Jesus Christ. You come to the New Testament, one out of every 25 verses in the New Testament, refer directly to the second coming of Christ. In fact, every time the Bible mentions the first coming of Christ, it mentions the second coming of Christ 8 times. And Jesus Christ himself refers to his second coming 21 times. And over 50 times we're told to be ready for his coming. And that's why in this chapter, the chapter wants us to learn how to live in constant readiness for Christ's return. And that shows you what we are considering now, the coming of the Lord, living in constant readiness for Christ's return. I've divided the chapter into 3 parts. Number one, an exhortation to Christ-like righteousness. The first part of the chapter, preparing us for the coming of the Lord, it's an exhortation to Christ-like righteousness. Number two, an experience of consistent renewal. You come to the Lord, you are renewed, and then there's a consistent renewal. It says an experience of consistent renewal. Number three, the expectation of Christ's return. The expectation of Christ's return. We come to number one, an exhortation to Christ-like righteousness. In chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 1. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us, how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. Here he talks about the Christian life. And he talks about the Christian life in the language of making progress consistently. And he talks in the language of walking. It says you have received of us. You have received instruction. You have received exhortation. You have received the word telling you how you will live, how you will behave, how you demonstrate the new life in Christ. In fact, other parts of the New Testament tell us very clearly how we're to live the Christian life. And it is described in the language of walking, a step after the other, a day after the other, living in the righteousness of the Lord. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. And then in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, still talking about the Christian life and describing the Christian life with the language of walking, consistently walking after the footsteps of the Lord. 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, he that says he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. We're to look at the life of Christ then, and we're to see how he walked, how he lived, how he behaved, and the actions that he had, and we are to follow after his steps. You will see from the very opening verse that this chapter we're looking at is intensely practical. Paul the apostle has passed from the thanksgiving, now is coming to practical exhortation on holiness and Christian living, and is beseeching the people, is earnestly exhorting them, is giving them entreaty. And he says the entreaty is by the Lord Jesus Christ. That means by the authority of the Lord, by the word of the Lord, by the revelation of the Lord. He was telling the Thessalonians how they were to live. We have mentioned the word walk. If you will pick up your New Testament and even the Old Testament, you will see that the New Testament and the Old Testament makes use of the word walk a lot of times. How are we to please the Lord? It simply says, number one, we're to walk in the light. 1 John 1:7. The light is there. Your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light across my pathway. Walk in the light of that word. John 8:12. He that followeth after me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And in Romans 6:4, we're to walk in the newness of life. The old is gone. Old lifestyle is gone. Walk in the newness of life. And then we're told in Romans 8:1, we walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. What are we told in 2 Corinthians 5:7? We walk by faith. Because whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Therefore, you forsaking all and you have trusted him, walk by faith. And then we're told that we're to walk as Christ walked. In Ephesians 4:17, we are not to walk after the Gentiles in the ignorance and darkness of their mind. Ephesians 5:15, we're to walk circumspectly. Coming to the Old Testament, in Psalm 84:11, we walk uprightly. And in Micah 6:8, we walk humbly with our God. And that's a clear passage, essential passage, when God was calling upon Abraham to come up higher in his spiritual life, when Abraham was 90 years and 9 old, and the Lord said, Abraham, walk before me and be thou perfect. And so the epistle we're looking at, chapter 4, opens with this consistent walk of the Christian life. And then it tells us in verse 2, it says, for ye know what commandment we give you by the Lord Jesus. And then it says in verse 3, for this is the will of God, even your sanctification. As it comes to the practical life of the believer, now he picks up that essential important word that leads us into another experience in the Lord. The first experience in the Lord you have, your sins are taken away, you are pardoned, you are forgiven, you have peace with God, you have salvation. But there is still something within, because sin is twofold. There is external sin, outward sin, like the branches of a tree. When you are born again, those branches are cut down. The external fruits are taken away. There is salvation. There is peace with God. There is newness of walk with the Lord. But the root of sin is still there. And the propensity for evil is still there. The Adamic nature is still there. The sin you were born with is still there. Sin, in its the nucleus of sin, is still there. The one that will produce other sins is still there. Therefore, you go back to the Lord. And when you go back to the Lord, you pray, you consecrate, you desire, you believe. And then he sanctifies. And then Paul the apostle said, this sanctification is the will of God. As he says, that is the will of God. There are four things I want to note for you. Number one, God's precept. Number two, God's purpose. Number three, God's promise. Number four, God's power. Sanctification is God's precept. It is his unalterable command and demand. It says, all his children must be pure, sanctified, and holy. And we have no choice, and there is no shortcut. We submit to that. Sanctification is the will of God. It's God's precept. Number two, it is the purpose of God. God's purpose. For this reason, Christ shed his blood. that he might sanctify us, that he may make us holy. Because we are told that Jesus, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, is suffered without the gate. But it's also God's promise. What man could not attain by self-effort himself, God has promised to do for us. If we're thirsty, if we pray, and if we believe. And so we know it's the promise of God. You know the promise of God when he says he himself, he will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. He will give you the flesh that's of the heart of flesh. And he also says that we might be delivered from our enemies, that we might serve the Lord without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. It is the promise of God. The very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray your whole spirit, soul, and body will be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. And we know it's by God's power. This sanctification we're talking about is effected by the power of God. Divine efficiency is capable of working out what he has purposed and what he has promised. And then we come back now to this 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 3. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. That brings some confusion in the hearts of some people. Does that mean that we are not free from fornication until we are sanctified? How is it that Paul the apostle is just talking about sanctification and now he says you must abstain from fornication? You need to understand the condition of the Thessalonian people. I told you before that Thessalonica was really very, very bad as a city. And there are three words you can think about when you think of Thessalonica. Number one, pornography. Number two, promiscuity. Number three, permissiveness. There was a terrible sin, obscenity, in that city. Everywhere you turned, you saw sin. Everywhere you went, sin was being practiced openly. And he said, now you must be, you have been saved. You have been born again. Your sins have been taken away. Even the outsiders, they have shown us what kind of entering in we had unto you, how ye turned from idols to serve the living God. But then I need to tell you that you must be sanctified. That is the will of God. But then sanctification, you still remember that the outside there, the outward life there is very, very bad, and therefore you still keep away from any shape or size or shadow of fornication or immorality. That teaches us something. Entire sanctification and inward purity will not belittle outward holiness and practical righteousness. As we're teaching the people, the deep life, the inward life, inward holiness, will still be reminding them in our illustrations, in our examples, all the bad things they'll see in society, so that they will not fall into them. In verse 4, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, that he will possess your body in holiness, in righteousness, and you will not allow anything of the world to affect your body, to affect your feeling, to affect your personality, to make you tend toward the world. You know how to present, how to possess your vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the lust of concupiscence, even as the Gentiles which know not God. It says we must be different from the Gentiles, from those who are outside Christ, that no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter, that you'll do unto others as you want them to do unto you. You don't want them to cheat you. You don't want them to defraud you. Neither will you cheat or defraud them, because the Lord is avenger of all sort. We also have for want you and testified. In Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, reading from verse 5, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, covetousness, which is idolatry. He says you'll be looking at that, and then you'll be watching your life, and anything that smacks of all those sins of the world, all those sins of the flesh, put them to death, mortify them, destroy them, get rid of them, for which thing's sake, in verse 6, the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. It says the wrath of God is coming on the children of disobedience. You say you are born again. You say you are the children of God. If the people that have no grace, if they get punished for doing those things, you who pretend or profess to have grace, if you do the same thing, the punishment of God will come upon you. It says in verse 7, in the which ye also walked, past tense, you are no more in that, at some time when ye lived in the past tense in them, but now because you are a child of God, put off all these. Anger shouldn't be there, wrath shouldn't be there, malice shouldn't be there, blasphemy, evil communication out of your mouth. And you lie not one to another, for any reason to cover up anything, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and ye have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. The point is, Paul the apostle was telling these believers that they needed to live a righteous life, a sanctified life, a pure life, a holy life, a life that will be glorifying unto the Lord, because that is the kind of life that is preparing the believers, preparing us for the return and the coming of the Lord. We go to point number 2, an experience of consistent renewal. An experience of consistent renewal. Look at it from verse 7 now of the chapter that we're looking at. It says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 7, for God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. It tells us the call of God. It's a high calling. It's a holy calling, and it's an heavenly calling. And it says that high calling, that holy calling, that heavenly calling is a call unto holiness, not a call unto uncleanness. Then it said in verse 8, he therefore that despises not man, but God, who also has given unto us his Holy Spirit. As we talk about the call of God to his children, that he calls us to holiness, he has not called us to uncleanness. You find that call is revealed in the whole Bible. It's revealed in the Old Testament. It's revealed in the New Testament as well. In Leviticus chapter 11. Leviticus chapter 11, verse 45. For I am the Lord that bringeth you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. Ye shall therefore be holy, for I am holy. It says there is a therefore. It says there is a cause. It says there is a basis. It says there is a condition. Because I am holy, and I'm the one that has brought you out of the land of captivity, out of the cage in which you were, and because you are now following after the Lord as children of God, you will have that same nature, you'll have that same desire, you'll have that same characteristic and attitude. You will be holy because I am holy. By inspiration, Peter picks that up, and he tells us exactly the same thing in the New Testament in 1 Peter. The same basis, the same reason for which they ought to be holy, is the same reason we ought to be holy as well. In 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 14, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former laws in your ignorance, but as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. You see the reason, be ye holy, not because you are a member of deeper life. Be ye holy, not because you are this denomination, that denomination. Be ye holy because he is holy. You know what? Churches may change, but God will not change. You know what? Conditions of life may change, and the people, religious people you are associated with, they may change. And if they change, that is not a reason for you not to be holy. You will not say, we used to emphasize holiness, we used to emphasize sanctification, we used to emphasize the purity of life and the purity of heart. Our emphasis is not that now. Since our emphasis has changed, I don't have to be holy anymore. No. The basis of holiness, the condition for holiness, the reason for holiness, the foundation of the holiness of life is not centered in denomination. It's not centered on theology of men. It's not centered on the examples of men. It's centered on the nature and the characteristic of the Almighty God. He changes not. And he says, because I am the ever-present I am. He was, he is, he will ever be. From eternity past unto eternity future, Almighty God is holy. And he says, because of that everlasting holiness of the Almighty God, because I am holy, you too, you will be holy. And then Paul tells us something very essential, very important in verse 8. He therefore that despises, despises not man, but God. Paul the apostle was saying, he that despises holiness was not despising the apostle Paul. He is despising God. In fact, he is despising the Godhead. If you oppose holiness, if you contradict holiness, number one, you despise God the Father. Number two, you disregard Christ the Son, who went to the cross and he found it necessary to shed his blood so that we can be sanctified. And then you dishonor the Holy Spirit that the Heavenly Father has sent through the mediation of Jesus Christ to abide with the church so that the holiness of life, holiness of heart can be maintained. You see how serious is it then when you despise holiness or sanctification? On the one hand, number one, you despise God. Number two, you disregard Christ. Number three, you dishonor the Holy Spirit, who is the foundation of true holiness in the believer's life. He who despises then grieves and insults the Almighty God, who has regenerated us and he wants to sanctify us. In this, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, look at it now in verse 9. He now comes to something practical. He's telling us what the holiness of heart will produce, what the sanctification will produce. In verse 9 and in verse 10, it says, but as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. When you have Christ dwelling in you, and you have the Lord present with you, he himself will be teaching you, if he's living in your heart, to love one another. Anytime temptation will come to manifest hatred or anger or malice or anything that is contrary to love, if Christ is inside your heart, he will remind you, that's not my nature. Nature of hatred, nature of malice, that's not my nature. You are born again, you are a child of God. He'll be teaching you, you ought to love one another. And then Paul the apostle said, you Thessalonians, this is something we realize the Lord has been teaching you, that you should love one another. In verse 10, indeed ye do it towards all the brethren. He testified about them that they were loving one another, and they loved everybody. No segregation, no partiality, no preferring this one to this other one. They loved one another. In fact, it said in church history, the Christians who loved one another, that an emperor commented and said, see how they love one another. And if that same experience will come back today into our hearts and lives, then people that see us, if we're living together, if we're working together, as we're relating together, when a believer gets into a problem and other believers come around that believer and they show love, practical love, they demonstrate love, the people of the world to you, they'll be able to say, see how they love one another. In verse 10, and indeed ye do it toward all the brethren, which are all in all Macedonia. But we beseech you, brethren, that ye increase more and more. He said, yes, you are doing well. Yes, you are doing the right thing. What we're saying is, don't let it stop. Let brotherly love continue, because it's by that the people will know that you belong to him. In John chapter 13. John chapter 13, reading from verse 34. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. A new commandment I give unto you, love one another. When you are happy with them, love one another. When it appears there are some things you don't understand, love one another. That's the central thing, the commandment, essential thing the Lord has given us. It says that you love one another. What's the measure? As I have loved you. When we were unlovable, he loved us. He even loved us to the point of dying for us. It is that example, it is that high standard of love we are to uphold. And it's that the love of Christ is love with all purity, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one towards another. But then, when there is love, sometimes love can be a covering for idleness and laziness. And then the believers can say, the other believers, they love me. They will take care of me, and they will take care of my need. And therefore, Paul the apostle wanted to settle that holiness, sanctification, purity, and love will not excuse idleness, just being idle and lazy and expecting the love of the other brethren to be taking care of your financial responsibilities. Come back to chapter 4, reading from verse 11. And that ye study to be quiet, and to do your own business, and to walk with your own hands, as we commanded you, that ye also walk honestly toward them that are without, that ye may have lack of nothing. And so you see the exhortation he was giving unto them. He was telling them that the holiness we're talking about and the love of one another we're talking about will not excuse laziness or idleness. We must walk honestly so that the name of God and the religion we uphold, the Christianity we uphold, will not be blasphemed. We come to point number three, the expectation of Christ's return. The expectation of Christ's return. These verses we're looking at now, verses 13 to 18, they talk about the rapture. They talk about the catching away of the saints. And the expectation of the Lord's return is not a new thing in the New Testament. If you will go back as far back as Job chapter 19, you will see that the saints of old, they too, they had the expectation that their Lord will come. And even if they died, that eventually there will be a resurrection and they will see the Lord face to face. Job chapter 19, reading from verse 25. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day, the last time, upon the earth, and do after my skin worms destroy this body. That means after death, yet in my flesh I shall see God. That means there'll be a resurrection, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eye shall behold him, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. So then you understand, from the time of the Old Testament, the people had been expecting that the Lord will eventually come, and those who had died as righteous people, they will be raised from the dead. Paul the apostle emphasized this in Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. Acts chapter 24, reading there from verse 15. It says, and have hope toward God, which did themselves also allow. He was giving his testimony. He said, I'm having hope towards God. And even these Jewish people who know nothing beyond the Old Testament, they themselves allow that. They themselves approve of that. They themselves know that that hope is a real living hope, that there should be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and of the unjust. In Titus chapter 2, verse 13. Titus chapter 2, verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, that he is coming again. And when he comes, he'll change our vile body. But if we have that hope that he will come, and we're expecting he will come for us, we must be in a state of readiness. In 1 John chapter 3, reading from verse 1, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because he knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Look at verse 3. And every man, no exception, if we're expecting the coming of the Lord, and if we know he's coming for us, and if we're getting ready for his return, every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. That's what Paul the apostle was telling the Thessalonians. He was talking about the coming of the Lord for the children of God, for the saints of God. He had already taught the Corinthians too, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 51. Here is what he told them about the coming of the Lord. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trump of God, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. I pray that you'll take part in that coming rapture, in Jesus' name. Now I want you to come back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We now want to just concentrate on these verses 13 to 18 that talks about the rapture of the church, the taking away of the people of God. Note three things there. Number one, Christ's return. Is returning, is coming again, so that he can take the saints away. Number two, the Christian's resurrection. That is, all those who have died asleep in Christ, they will be raised up from the dead. Number three, the church's rapture. The people that are still alive, members of the body of Christ, living in him, the bride of Christ, they will be taken up, and they will join those people. Look at it from verse 13. In verse 13, it says, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. Put there, number one, there is a realization. A realization, you see, he was telling them, realize something. Because, you know, these Thessalonian believers, they knew the Lord was coming. And the thing that bothered them is that, although we know the Lord is coming, when will he come? Some of us are already falling asleep. Some of us are already dying. Does that mean that they have missed the gathering together unto him? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him. They knew that he would come, and they knew that we'll be gathering together unto him. Therefore, they had a question. How about those who have died? Have they missed that glorious gathering unto the Lord? He said, number one, there is a realization. I will not want you to be ignorant. I want you to be well taught that those who have died, they didn't die in vain. Look at verse 14. It says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so also them which sleep in Christ will God bring with him. Number two, there is a repose. That is, the bodies of the people that died in Christ, they are now resting. It's not so sleep. You remember when Stephen was going to die, it says, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And after his spirit had been deposited with the Lord, then the Bible says the body fell asleep. The people that are sleeping, that means the people that died in Christ, it's just their body, it's a repose, a temporary resting. 14 of the body. Then in verse 15, it tells us, because for this we say unto you, by the watch of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede, shall not prevent, shall not hinder them which are asleep. Number three, there is a revelation, the revelation of Christ. When Christ himself, when he will come, and then he says, these will say, how do you know this, Paul? It's by revelation, by the watch of the Lord. He says, we have a revelation. And the revelation is that we which are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord, we're not going to hinder, we're not going to prevent the people that are falling asleep. We got that by a revelation from the Lord. And then in that, in verse 16, it says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. It says the Lord shall descend. There is a return. It's gone away. He will return. He will come again. And then in that same verse, it says the dead in Christ shall rise first. There is going to be a resurrection. Number one, there's a realization. Number two, there is a repose of the body when those Christians die. Number three, there is a revelation from the Lord. We're telling you this by the revelation of the word of the Lord. Number four, there is a return because Christ will descend. It's coming again. Number five, there is a resurrection because the dead in Christ shall rise. And then in verse 17, then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them. There is a rapture. The rapture is referring to when Christ will come, and then the church, we which are still alive, will be magnetized up, and then we will go with him. And then it says, when we are caught up together with them to meet him in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. To meet him, there is a reunion. The bridegroom had gone, the bride is waiting for him, and then the trumpet shall sound. And when Christ the bridegroom shall come, then the church, which is the bride here on earth, we will be together with him. There is a reunion. And then in verse 18, it says, wherefore comfort one another with these words. There is a reassurance. We are reassuring ourselves as he was telling them to comfort one another. Why? Because some of them had died. And those people that died, they were getting worried. Are we going to see them again? Are we going to meet them again? He said, comfort them, reassure them. We are going to see them, and we will know one another, see one another. As we look at these verses, I want to round up. And as I round up, I give you two things. Number one, the pillars of the rapture. The pillars of the rapture. Number two, the participants of the rapture. The pillars of the rapture, that is the rapture we're talking about, and the rapture that the Lord himself has revealed unto us, and which the word is teaching us. This rapture, on which pillars are they built? Two pillars. Number one, the pillar of the resurrection of Christ. Number two, the pillar of the revelation of Christ. Look at it from verse 14. It says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus with God bring with him. If we believe that Jesus rose again on the basis of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, then we ourselves, we will be raptured, will be taken away with him. Then he says in verse 15, for this we say unto you. On what basis? By what authority? With what assurance? We say unto you, by the word of the Lord. That's the revelation of Christ, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of our Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. And then the participants of the rapture. Who are the people that will participate in that rapture when the Lord will come? Number one, the righteous who are alive in Christ. Number two, the redeemed who are asleep in Christ. Number one, the righteous who are alive in Christ. It tells us in those verses, it says the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. and with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And then he says, and we which are alive and remain and shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. You can see that very clearly. The righteous, those who are in Christ, they are alive in Christ. Christ is living in them, and they are living in Christ. When Christ shall come, the Lord will take them away. And then before they are taken away, those who are asleep in Christ, before they died, they were in Christ, new creatures in Christ, separated from the world, separated unto the Lord. And before the coming of the Lord, they are died, their spirits are being with the Lord, but their body is in the grave. On the resurrection morning, they will be resurrected, they will be raised from the dead. And then we which are alive, we will be together with them in Jesus' name. I'm sure you want to be there. I said, I'm sure you want to be there. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to do what? To prepare a place for who? For you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Is he coming again? And receive you unto myself, so that where I am, I said, where I am, there you will be also. Do you want to be there? Rise up and tell the Lord, I want to be there. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. And he's calling all his children. Get ready. Be prepared. Live in righteousness. Live in holiness. In readiness. In preparation for the coming of the Lord. He's coming. My brothers and sisters, he's coming. And if you will prepare yourself and remain holy and righteous, whatever is happening around you, let the grace of God be sufficient in your life. And then when he comes, you'll be among the people of God that will go with him. Pray, please. Open your mouth and pray.